of the cosmos.
Welcome to Whale's World. I'm your host for the next hour or two. My name is Andy Whale, current drummer of Memoriam and Darkened, and of course, ex-drummer of Bolt Thrower. Good evening. You're listening to Metal Messiah Radio, and this is Andy Whale. You're listening to Whale's World Lockdown Show. Now tonight I've got a bit of a special. I didn't just want to play songs, talk about songs. So I got in touch with one of my very old friends, Mr. Karl Willetts. I challenged him earlier in the week to pick five songs / bands that basically inspired him over the years. Really, what we've ended up doing is having a 45-minute chat with each other and just playing some songs basically. So I'm going to play a song just to get us going, and then I'm going to introduce Mr. Willetts. Anyway, this is Discharge and Decontrol. You probably know Discharge were a massive influence for me. Gary Maloney, massive influence on my drumming style. But this week's challenge was to get Karl Willetts, my old bandmate, current bandmate, to pick his influences. So let's get this little chat started straight away. I've known you for a long time anyway, Karl. I mean, obviously, we've known each other since, the mid-80s, something like that, early 80s?
Yeah.
I sort of, know some of the music that you have listened to over the years, but, I mean, really, the idea I've got is to get you to tell us your people that inspired you and gave you inspiration to basically be where you are today, really.
Yeah, it's an opportunity to kind of document
things that have really made an impact or kind of like made me kind of who I am. And yet, as you say, we kind of go back 30 plus years, you know, we've known each other since we were quite young, and the music, we both like the kind of similar kind of stuff, and it's kind of inspired us and made us who we are. So yeah, I think it's important to kind of get some of these songs to people that maybe not, we might not have heard of them, you know. So yeah, it's a really good opportunity to do that.
So I mean, anyway, so if we go right back to not so much the beginning, but really, what would have been the first sort of bands or the, you know, that would have inspired you? I mean, you know, so.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting. Yeah, you know, throughout my life, you know, I've always been really interested in fashion. From the age of 13, I've been, you know, interested in music. Even when I was a young child, I come from a kind of like a musical family. All my brothers and that were in bands in the 60s that were, you know, fairly successful to a point. You know, they kind of like did supporting gigs for bands like The Who and The Kinks on the club circuit around the UK. And my dad was a band manager. He's an entertainment kind of agent. So, you know, from a very early age, I was always aware of musicians coming to my house. You know, it's like Steve Winwood and you know, fairly famous kind of people coming to that. So I was always aware of music from a very early age. And you know, I remember, you know, probably the first album I ever heard was, you know, because that really kind of got me into music was a band, was Boy by U2. I remember hearing that and it really made an impact and made me think, wow, that's a really, really exciting, different kind of thing that I'd never really heard of before. And it all kind of grew from there, really, you know. And you know, back when we were kids, when I was growing up, it was like all subcultures, you know. I mean, it was all very different to how music is today. You know, you kind of defined your identity through the music that you listened to. So you were either a mod or you were a rocker or a teddy boy or a skinhead or a rude boy, or yeah, and you kind of like listened to that specific genre of music and you kind of like dressed in that way as well. And it kind of all grew from that point onwards, really. But I think that really to the point where, you know, I started to really define myself as who I am was in the 80s, really. And that was really kind of the influence of kind of like the post-punk, the punk kind of music that was around at that point. And, you know, one band that really kind of stands out to me that kind of remains a constant throughout my life, which I always draw reference to lyrically, musically, inspirationally, you know, politically, is a band called Killing Joke. I mean, for me, they are just the ultimate consummate band, you know, musically and lyrically. Jazz Coleman is my personal hero. He's an absolute icon of mine, and his musical style, they've always, for me, throughout the 30 or 40 years of their existence, they've always had their finger on the pulse of what's going on in the world around them, and they've constantly changed and evolved their sound and grown. And kind of, I feel that I've kind of grown up with them as a band. They're my band. In fact, at my funeral, well, you've got to remember this. At my funeral, when it happens, I want Love Like Blood to be played.
So, Killing Joke, Love Like Blood. I mean, moving on a little bit. I mean, me and you, we've always been around the Birmingham scene anyway. Like, you know, we're into all those kind of bands. But then when we sort of like moved on, and you know, we actually got into bands, didn't we? You know, like, i.e. Bolt Thrower, you know. And so where did you go from there, really? Because in a way, we did change quite, we got sort of like sideswiped in a way, didn't we, musically, by all the early, you know, grind and, you know, up and coming death metal bands, really. So where would you go from there, anyway?
Yeah, I think that's actually a really good point. I think, you know, as I said, that, I think people's, my identity is totally forged through music. It's made me who I am. And, as you say, we used to kind of, growing up, when we got to, kind of my formative years, getting up to 18, 19, we used to go to all these gigs around Birmingham. The Dig Basilic Hall, and the infamous Mermaid, which it was just like mecca really for everyone that was involved in this new kind of emerging scene, which was really kind of like unique and quite exciting to be a part of, because it kind of felt like you were part of it. You were kind of, you owned that was your music. We kind of grew up, and that we kind of like. That's how we kind of felt who we are. We belong to this kind of little clique, this kind of like a group of people going to the Mermaid and listening to all these extreme bands. And every weekend you get all sorts of bands like Godflesh or Napalm Death or all these up and coming grind crust bands that were kind of like playing. Like the whole crass anarcho punk scene was developing quite strong. And really, that's really the first point really where I felt that I kind of latched onto something that I could believe in. It's like more of a, not just the music itself, it's an ideology behind it as well that kind of like really kind of hit home with me as well. So, but I remember one specific night, a defining moment in my life, like almost kind of like an epiphany, of when I was standing at the Mermaid and I was watching a band called Sacrilege perform. I think it was a couple of days before my 21st birthday, actually. Yeah. And, it was actually at that point I kind of like stood and watched this band, and I thought, I'd like to do that. I want to be up there. I want to do that. I was watching Tam, and I was totally inspired by what she was doing and the way she kind of like engaged with the audience. I knew I wasn't particularly musically, competent in any way, but being a vocalist, to me, just watching her perform and the band, kind of together and the way it all kind of like welded together and engaged with the audience, that was the point where I thought, I want to be in the band, I want to do that, I want to be up there and do that. So Sacrilege was, a really, really integral, important part of my musical history. I can't understate the amount of influence that they've had on me as an individual and made me who I am today, really.
Yeah, I know what you mean. I actually remember that show, actually. And I totally agree with you about Sacrilege. They were just, they just suddenly appeared, didn't they? And they just changed things, didn't they? But they did it in a way that you could relate to them, because you actually knew them. You could sort of like say, I can actually do that, like you say. So anyway,
I mean, that's it, because it was just a total new kind of like sound that they was creating. It was like the old grind crust punk kind of sound, which we were used to, but they kind of like welded this like new kind of like aggressive punk side of things, but with this kind of musicianship of metal, which was just emerging. We just kind of heard these early demos coming through from bands like, Metallica and Slayer and things like that. And they kind of like managed to kind of like put those two sounds together and create something totally different, which was absolutely awe-inspiring at the time. And it was like a whole tsunami of music that kind of like developed. So I think the next song that I've got to choose really would be a song by Sacrilege called Lifeline.
Right then, so, yeah, okay. Sacrilege, absolutely brilliant band. Like, Damien is an absolute genius. Andy Baker is, in my mind, such an underrated drummer. But, I mean, from then really, then you actually got into a band, didn't you? You know, I mean, obviously, you know, I mean, with Bolt Thrower, when Alan left, and we asked you to join.
Yeah, that was your fault, Wales. It was more my luck than judgment. I think really because, yeah, you know, I knew you, we used to hang out, and we had that connection, yeah, to music. And, yeah, with Tom as well, my best mate.
Yeah, yeah.
Related to your ex, you know. So I think like, there was a close connection there. And, you know, I kind of like, I was driving the band. I remember I used to be the roadie for the band, driving, I didn't used to carry anything, but I used to drive the band around, I don't carry anything to that, but I used to drive the band around to all the gigs, and that was what I used to do. And I think really kind of like when Alan, the original vocalist, decided that he couldn't commit himself to the band as they started to kind of get more popular and get a lot of stuff, he decided to, it wasn't for him, so it was kind of almost natural that I kind of like stepped into that void that he left, because I knew everyone in the band. I kind of got on with you. You know, you still need someone to drive you. So it kind of like worked out that I kind of fell into the role by default, as it seems, really.
Yeah.
And yeah, we had a great time. Didn't we? We kind of like, you know, six, 10, 15 years of having a great boss doing it. And yeah, that's what kind of like helped forge me as who I am today, really. And but yeah, there were such a lot of really, really, really good bands around at that time, you know, lots of really kind of exciting new sounding bands that kind of like I latched onto, really enjoying it. Bands like Antisect,
yeah,
you know, from Amoebix, you know, there's also bands like from the Anarcho Crust scene that I really, really into, like Flux of Pink Indians, Crass, of course, Conflict, all those sort of bands, you know, kind of that forged a really, really good healthy scene here in the UK, and managed to like stamp the name of the UK on the world map of music, yeah, from my perspective in that time. But yeah, there's one band that really kind of jumps out and stands out to me from that period that really kind of had a big influence on me. Their first album that they released, called Rise a Star, was different as well. It was quite atmospheric and quite different, and that's why I kind of enjoyed listening to them. And they did a track off that album called War Machine, which is definitely one up there that I definitely feel that we've got to play it to the people and get them to hear Axegrinder, War Machine.
What, with the all the intro, or am I allowed to cut it off?
Cut to you. If you want to get rid of the intro, you can do, but it does build up to it quite nicely.
Yeah. Axegrinder, because we played with Axegrinder
I think we should, I still think we should do a cover version of it, because I really want to get a little Bon Tempe keyboard and do that intro.
Yeah. But we used to do a lot of shows with Axegrinder back in the day, didn't we? So but they are, I mean, live, they're an absolute brilliant band, aren't they? They're just really, you know, they're always heavy. But do you know what?
Yeah. Yeah, we're gonna... It's great to see they're back and still doing it today as well, you know, and the long may they continue as well. So, it's all good to see. Yeah, so if you could play for me, Mr. Whale, Axegrinder, War Machine.
We will. We'll get it on now. Right then. So yeah, Axegrinder, absolutely brilliant band. We used to play with them quite a lot. Mainly we seem to play with them in Bradford, didn't we, for some bonkers reason. We always seem to play with them.
Yeah!
But anyway...
We played with them quite a few times. Yeah, back in the day, we used to regularly play across the UK. Yeah, virtually every other weekend, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't think there's a band from the UK that we haven't played with, really. Yeah, we've played regularly with Paradise Lost and with Carcass and, you know, Antisept, Deviate Instinct. All those bands were kind of like, you know, used to play with on a regular basis. And yeah, it was a good feeling of... no kind of like feeling of competition, really. It was all very kind of like supportive and a kind of feeling of camaraderie going on there, you know. And it was a great thing to be involved with, you know. And it was exciting times.
Yeah, I mean, but then after that, we seemed to get... We seemed to sort of... Well, I mean, I suppose ball throwing away. We started moving more afield, didn't we? We got to play in Europe, we got to play America, we got to play Australia, and we just started like listening to bigger bands as well, didn't we? Well, not so much bigger bands, but, you know, what I'd class as bigger bands in a way, like, you know. But I mean, did any of those sort of like, you know, sort of like have an inspiration on you in any way?
Definitely, yeah. I don't think it'd be right to discount the influence that, say, some of the bands, the larger bands, had. Yeah, we kind of, I remember, you know, the whole tape trading scene, which was a massive thing in the 80s, you know, and getting tapes off people, off the very early Metallica demos, and, Anthrax, and all these kind of, these American bands, you know, not just those as well, you know, bands from Europe as well, you know, there's a big Swedish scene that was developing, and the European scene, so it was really exciting to feel, to realise that it was not just a little thing that was going on in the UK, it was a bit of a global phenomenon going on, and bands from right across the world, you know, I used to really look forward to kind of getting those packages in the morning, you know, from exotic, strange, faraway countries like Peru and things like that, with the latest kind of like underground death metal kind of music that was coming from there, and it was great. It's before the internet, and it was kind of great to feel it was interconnected. And yeah, as you say, the band developed, and instead of playing gigs in our local town, we started to play further afield, you know, London, and then we started to play even further afield, like in Europe. You know, our first tour over there with Autopsy and Pestilence was phenomenal. And then again, further afield than that, yeah, going up to America and Australia, and the band grew and grew and grew. And yeah, as the band grew and developed, the sound of the band changed as well. So, you know, we were originally defined as a grindcore band. Yeah, our first couple of albums were defined as that. But we kind of in Hamilton, we took on more of a metallic kind of edge, maybe, yeah, more of an extreme metal kind of sound that we had. So yeah, I think bands like, you know, early Metallica and Slayer and things like that really played an important part on in kind of like letting us know that we were kind of more interconnected with the world around us as well, and playing an important part of this overall beat kind of genre that was developing, and, you know, has developed to the point where it's still really strong even today, 30 years on down the line. You know, old school death metal is really, really, really strong, and I always, you know, remember hearing these tapes of bands and then going to the a record shop, you're buying the magazines like Metallion and things, and hearing that these bands have got records coming out, and going to the little small independent record shops in Birmingham, flicking through the albums and picking one or two out, and then taking it home and playing it really, really loud, and it had a massive impact, and the feeling was just totally raw and different. Yeah, so one of the very first records from that kind of, you know, not a UK punk band, would be an EP that I bought from a band called Slayer. they did an EP called Launch in the Chapel, and there's a track off that called Chemical Warfare. So I think that would be a really good track for you to play next. Well, Chemical Warfare.
No problem. Yeah, we'll do that then. Get that on right away. Always, I remember that they were the first time. I think the first time me and you ever saw Slayer was down at the Marquee, wasn't it? We used to go down to London quite a lot, didn't we? We used to jump on the coach. Quite a few of us did, didn't we? We'd all jump on the coach. We'd get down there, a few beers, sort of like we'd go to whatever shows were going on at the time. I think one of the other ones was it Voivod Possessed and English Dogs? You know,
Voivod Possessed English Dogs.
And then we'd get absolutely
down in London. Often, you know, kind of like missing the last coach home and Victoria Coach Station, which was always good fun.
Called The Sonics. she's an evil gin. Say she's the witch. She got a long black hair and a big black car. I know what you're thinking, but you won't get far. She's gonna make it live, 'cause she's the witch. Where she wants to run, late at night, won't stop the people sleeping tight. If you hear a knocking on your door, you better sneak it away. Wahoo! Wah, baby, I'm out! Now you know the score, 'cause I said she's fair. But you better be careful, it's too late. She's gonna make you ill, 'cause she's the witch.
Okay, no problem. Yeah. Well, I'm sure that'll take everybody's surprise anyway. But man, to be honest, that I just on this show, I'll just play what I want anyway. Like, so we do play a few bits and pieces. But no, that's
it. I think everyone's gonna have an open ears to different types of music and accept different types of things. It makes it a much more interesting world to live in if you embrace all types of music, as long as it moves your soul. That's all that matters.
Yeah, that's it. That's all that it matters about. Anyway, I can only thank you enough for this. Anyway, and it's been really interesting just putting, you know, going through your life and just seeing the sort of like inspiration, because I've known you for a long time, so I know that you like loads of different music, but it's quite interesting to just like let people in on it really sometimes, and just see how people get inspiration and in a way what has made people like Killing Joke, all that kind of stuff, you know, all that like political stuff. Yeah. But
that's just a very small snippet. We could probably talk all night about it, couldn't we? We do, yeah. We're together, we're in the band. That's what we generally tend to talk about, is bands and music, isn't it, really? So, it's quite nice to have this opportunity to do this, you know, especially at this time where everything is on hold, everyone's life's on hold, and it's quite nice to be able to talk about stuff, and I'm kind of itching really to get back at it. It's quiet downtime. We can't even rehearse because we're all socially isolating. I haven't seen you for about 3 weeks, which is a bit strange. So you usually see at least once a week.
Yeah.
So and that's what we enjoy doing, is getting to that rehearsal room and having a laugh and rehearsing. So yeah, it's quite nice on a social level just to have a chat to you about the music that I like, which is nice.
Yeah, but like I say, thanks for that. Anyway, I know the line's been a bit crackly, but I think there's just some problems with the network at the moment because everything's just overstretched, isn't it, I think, at the moment. But anyway...
All the networks, the phone networks are on meltdown, aren't they, because everyone's using the phones, aren't they? And, it's just gone crazy. But hopefully I will see you soon on the other side of this madness.
Yeah, we'll be better people for it as well. But anyway... Thanks for that anyway, and stay safe, mate.
Always a pleasure.
Take care.
Mate. You take it easy. I'll see you soon, mate. Take it easy.
Bye-bye. Classic track by At the Gates, Blinded by Fear. Absolute classic band. Love the guys. They're always good fun to catch up with. Played with those guys a couple of years ago with Memoriam over in Greece. Lineup was At the Gates, Unleashed, and Memoriam. Absolutely brilliant show. I think the first time I ever played with At the Gates was 1991, our school stooner. Me and Adrian, every time I see him, always have a bit of a chuckle about that show. Absolute classic show. Anyway, getting to the end of this lockdown show. Like I say, I hope you enjoyed the chat with Mr. Willetts, going through his, songs that inspired him over the years. There were some good songs in there, and a couple of ones we'd never expect to hear, I suppose, as well. I'm going to keep that on, that going anyway, and I'm going to play another track, Smashing Pumpkins and Zero.
Just like me.
Right in, Smashing Pumpkins, Zero. I will argue the toss all day long about this song. I just love it. It is a great song. It is just a pure rock and roll song. That riff is just brilliant. Anyway, Wales World Lockdown Show, part two, all done and dusted. I hope you enjoyed the little chat with Karl. I know I did. It brought back a few fond memories, so that was all good. Next week's show is... An Old Men Play Death Metal request show. I am involved with a little group on Facebook. So basically what I've done is I've put it out to all those guys and ladies. Whatever tracks they want me to play, I'm going to try and play them. Anyway, thank you for listening. And I will talk to you next week, hopefully. Take care. Bye-bye.